Hey, happy Mother's Day, everybody. I have more to say about moms later as God's will would have it. We're going to be talking about two of the most famous mothers in the Bible, Mary and Elizabeth, later today in God's Word. So I have more to say about that, but I just wanted to start the service by saying happy Mother's Day. Thank you for being here and worshiping with us. We're going to get into the Word in a minute. We're going to get into worship in a minute, but I wanted to talk to you first about what God is doing in our body. If you got our text message, our email, or saw us on Facebook this week, you know that I talked a lot about something that I had to share with you. And I bet it's probably no secret by now, like what in the world I might share with you. But you know, before I even give you any details about the big news that we have and what God is doing in our body, I just want to remind you of how amazingly and wonderfully good God is. I mean, He gives to us, prepares things for us, blesses us, takes care of us in ways that we never could even imagine. And I'm going to be sharing a little bit with you about that. But I just want to read you this scripture to start this morning. It's Luke 11, 9 through 13. It says, "And I tell you, ask and it will be given to you. Seek and you will find. Knock and it will be opened to you. For everyone who asks receives, and the one who seeks finds, and to the one who knocks it will be opened. What father among you, or our Father in heaven, if his son asks for a fish, will instead of a fish give him a serpent? Or if he asks for an egg, will he give him a scorpion? If you then, who are evil, know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will the heavenly Father give the Holy Spirit to those who ask him?" And I just want you to know that through this whole journey of being out of our building at Rimrec for longer than a year, God has given to us abundantly. God has provided for us in all of the ways that we needed. God has given us people and resources and provision and blessing and leaders and talent beyond belief. I mean, what's even just happened on the worship team in the last year has been incredible, with the addition of numbers and people who have a heart for the Lord. It's just been so, so encouraging. And all the while during this year of being gone from our old location with the rec center and the Thousand Pines coming to our rescue and saying, "Meet here." I mean, it's just been quite a journey. And over the last year, the elders and I have left no rock unturned about where we were going to go next. Because we knew there was a day and a time where it's going to be time for Thousand Pines to open back up. And by the way, God did an amazing miracle there. The county's letting Thousand Pines open, not just partially, but open entirely, right? 100%, which is unbelievable. After a year of just weathering those storms here, the camp weathering those storms, but inviting us here, God is just returning that blessing to them. But during that whole time, we were searching and looking. We've looked at buildings to rent. We've looked at them to buy, to lease, to share. I'd even had some conversations with other churches about coming together and working together. And all the while we were searching, God was at work the entire time. And I literally mean the entire time. And during a year where we would look back and say, "Wow, what a year 2020 was," God had a plan through the whole thing. Not only just to be good to this church, but to be good to this community. And I want Steve to just share a little bit about that, because the story of what's happened with Thousand Pines and the story of what's happened with the lake connects directly with Woodlands. And so would you just share with me, Steve, what kind of you shared a little bit on Monday about just how God even brought the partnership with Thousand Pines and the lake together?
Yeah. You know, in 2019, there was a company that was finishing up the rebuilding of the dam at Lake Gregory here. And a lot of people don't know the historic connection between Lake Gregory, the town of Crestline, and this camp. But Arthur Gregory was a developer, and in 1938, he was finishing up the construction of the dam. And at the time, they had designed an entire community with this kind of a little Switzerland in mind, which is why so many of our streets have those goofy names. You know, we got Zugler and Zell and Dell and Webern and Weisshorn. Right? And we have all of these Swiss names because he imagined this town, which was at the time, you know, it had gone through in the late 1800s, a logging period and pioneer time. There was even some, I was recently reading some old mining records right here in the middle of the town. And then after the logging industry had moved on, there was still some folks left behind, little villages here and there. And so he had this vision. Arthur Gregory was a developer, a successful citrus farmer down in Redlands area. And he had a vision for what this community could become. So he started to develop that out, owned a lot of the property up here. In doing so, he also designed this little lake down here. And he had thought at the time that what he would do with that is that he would give the lake away at some point. It would initially be private, and at some point it would move on. And I don't know if he envisioned the future the way how it's come together, but I think God was in this thing all along. You see, he was sitting on the board of the University of Redlands, and he made friends with a guy by the name of Dr. Catherwood. Dr. Catherwood was a pastor at First Baptist Riverside. And Dr. Catherwood and Arthur made good friends, and at some point they shared their faith with one another. And Dr. Catherwood convinced Arthur Gregory to donate the first acreage up here to be a ministry. And in 1938, they sold the first 10 acres of Thousand Pines to the Southern California Baptist Convention. They sold the first 10 acres for $10. And began the ministry of Thousand Pines, what is now Thousand Pines Christian Camp. I don't know if Arthur Gregory ever imagined what would happen from there, but this ministry began. He also dug a big hole in the middle of our town and started to build a dam, and they weren't quite done. They figured it would take somewhere between 4 and 7 years for enough runoff to fill up the lake. A big storm came through, and about 4 days later, we had a lake. And there's still equipment and things at the bottom of that lake that never got pulled out. 80 years later, the dam needed to be rebuilt. And in 2019, as they were completing the dam, conversation started to go out about the running of Lake Gregory and that the county was going to put that lake up. I initially got invited into the conversation because our friends who were completing the dam itself, doing the major construction, they got invited in the conversation to run Lake Gregory, and they said, well, we want to know what this is about. And so they asked me to help put together a little cost model. And it's the kind of things that we know how to do. They've got a skate park, we have a skate park. They do concessions, we do concessions. They do weddings, we do weddings. They do food, we do food. They have trails, 100-acre property down there. We have 250 acres up here, lots of trails and maintenance. We're familiar with this operation. So they said, Steve, can you help out and put some costs together to run Lake Gregory? What does it really cost to do this? And a couple weeks into that process, the county released what they called a request for proposal. They said, we want somebody to come run Lake Gregory for us, for the county, and we're looking for just the right people. Here's all the things that we want to see. And as we read the RFP, we very quickly realized that neither their company nor our company individually was quite right to run that. But together, we had a great partnership that would meet what the county needed. In 2019, we began to do our homework, put a business plan together, and we made a pitch along with a few other contenders to run Lake Gregory. We weren't initially selected. In 2019, they chose a different company. And we made it through the end of 2019 and kind of came into 2020. Had a great year of ministry here at the camp, probably the biggest winter camps we've ever had, the biggest year of ministry that we've ever had, the most number of campers we've ever had. Had some big gifts that came in, and things were looking bright. The beginning of 2020, we started to hear rumblings about COVID internationally. And it was March 13th, somewhere around there, when we got a notice from the county, more or less a closure notice, a cease and desist order. And we were, at that point, instructed to close down. We were running 7 days a week. We'd see 200 campers during the week with our science camp. We'd see several hundred on the weekend, sometimes 300, 400, 500, just depending on the weekend. And so we were seeing somewhere in the neighborhood, depending on the week, of 700 to 1,000 campers a week. And immediately that ended. I went from having 140 employees here at Thousand Pines to having somewhere at the lowest point, 23. But the Lord provided for us all along. There was some government assistance. Our donors, we didn't even ask for like a Save Thousand Pines fund or anything like that. We just prayed and said, we're going to follow you, Lord, whatever you want us to do. Open the door, show us what you want us to do. Initially, we were baking bread We were given a pallet of flour, and so we were able to make thousands of loaves of bread, and we just gave bread to the community. Pretty soon there was a need to deliver groceries, and a lot of our staff just jumped in and started delivering groceries in the community. Some started working for Luetti's or working for Good Ones because we were able to deliver groceries. And immediately there was a request from churches. One of them was, of course, Woodlands. And the request was, is there any way we can use some of the buildings, maybe some Wi-Fi? So we started doing some online together. We were out there in Whittier, and we would get together on Sunday mornings and broadcast from there. That got old pretty quick, didn't it? We loved doing it, but at the same time, the desire was to be together as a body. As the weather got warmer, we had the opportunity to meet outdoors. And when the state of California opened up for churches to meet outdoors, socially distancing, that's what we put a plan together, and we began to meet on the lawn. How many of you guys were here at that time, meeting on the lawn? It was a wonderful time, wasn't it?
Yeah.
We had some windy days. We had some overly hot days. But it was a blessing to be together, to worship and to pray and to praise the Lord, and to be in the Word and just be in fellowship. And so we began to do that. We went through the summer. And as we looked to the weather changing in the fall, we needed to come up with another plan. And at the time, we initially said, hey, you know what, why don't we come in this building? We'll open the doors. And, you know, we got lots of airflow. We can be in this building. And we talked about how to make this work. And so Dan and I and the elders and others, we got together and put a plan. And our first Sunday to come in here, a big storm rolled in. And it was 34 degrees outside, and those doors did not open. We opened the back door. It was a breezy draft that was coming through, you know. And for the many of you, you've been along with us on the journey ever since. Well, in the course of the year, as COVID hit in 2020, the company that the county had selected to run Lake Gregory, they kind of got the rug pulled out from under them. They were an international company, a global company that ran big sports arenas like Citizens Arena in Ontario. And they got the rug pulled out from them. Immediately their business dried up. They were not expanding any longer. And I reached out to the county in the spring of 2020. I said, hey, I've got 140 employees at the time. I still did. And we're trained, we're ready, you need lifeguards, we've got lifeguards, you need people to run food, we can do all kinds of things. And it was too soon. County wasn't ready to take action then. But we started a conversation, and as the months went on, by the end of the year, we were zeroing in on closing a deal, if you will, for Thousand Pines to create a new company that is now called, you may recognize, see some stuff down there at the lake, but the Lake Gregory Company is now running Lake Gregory. And to speak to what your question was, I'm sorry for the long-winded.
It was a great story. I was captivated here. And you know what? Everybody in this room loves the information because everybody's like, what in the world's going on with the lake? So everybody knows the story now.
We've created a new company. We're hiring new people. We're building a new, if you will, ministry right in the heart of our community. Now, what are we doing down there? We're running a lake. We've got beaches to open. We've got a skate park to fix and repair. We've got trails to maintain. We've got a zillion logs that need to be removed, right? Yeah. We have a whole bunch of boats, canoes, kayaks, paddle boards, rowboats, you name it, that we are buying and need to replace because all of that walked away with the previous company. And we're restoring old buildings. And we're opening things back up. And I believe this is a call of God. Although we are just running the business down there, our purpose in doing so, in being partners with the community, in being partners with the county, in being partners with local business owners and vendors in the Chamber of Commerce and everyone involved, is to be a light in the darkness, to be a city on a hill. I think God's called us not just to be a hidden ministry up here doing our little camping thing, which is wonderful. We see 38,000 campers a year through this ministry. But they usually come from other places to come up here to do ministry. We have camps, we preach the gospel, kids come to the Lord, and they go back home wherever they're at, and I think we're having a great impact because of this ministry. But through COVID, we've been able to open up as a campground. In fact, some of our family campers are here this weekend, and parking's been a little difficult for you, I know. But we've been able to open this ministry up to serve others and show Christ, and I believe that this next step in being down at the lake and running the lake is just another extension of that. It's God allowing us to be involved in our community in a practical way. And by the way that we, Jesus said this, they will know that you're my disciples by the size of your giant Bibles. That's not what he said, right? They will know that you're my disciples by your
love.
By your love for one another. And so as we do this, if we do it with excellence, if we do it with honor and with integrity, I think we show Christ in all the things that we do.
Yeah, so thanks for that story, Steve. And I'm going to ask you something again. You can sit down for a second. So maybe you're wondering why we told that big story. It's because the story of Woodlands and the story of Thousand Pines and the story of the lake, they just completely converge only by God's plan, not by ours. Because of what God is doing, and because he wants the church and the ministry to be at the center of his town, this partnership with Thousand Pines has allowed us to receive as our permanent location, the biggest, the best, the most beautiful building in all of Crestline, which is the San Moritz Lodge. It's going to be our permanent location. It's not temporary. Is it going to be shared space? It still is going to be a little bit of shared space. But Steve has opened it up for us that we could be there anytime. There's nothing else going on there. And just to give you a little bit of how I think about this, I feel like the elders and I were walking around looking at rags to clothe our church in. And God was like, no, for my church, for my bride, here's the best. It's so beautiful what God does when we don't see it. He just gave us the best that he possibly could, a place where we can grow and love. We can be at the center of what he's doing. We can baptize people right out the back door. I mean, just the things that we're going to be able to do there are beyond comprehension. And so I just want you guys to see a couple of these pictures real quick, and then we'll move on with the service. But you can see, you've probably been to the building, but there's tons of parking, and it's flat parking, which is amazing. So very flat, easy to get in. No more golf carts. Can I get an amen? Go back to that last picture. By the way, just since we're talking about it, go back one, Ezra, please. Right along this side of the building, we want to reserve that for people who are handicapped or just have a problem getting in or out. There's a door right there on the side, so if you're capable of walking, go park there, okay? If you need an easy way in and out, park right there. That's for you. Okay, go ahead, Ezra. Pop it through. There's tons of parking. It's free parking. They're not gonna be going through there when we're there on Sundays, worried about parking passes or anything like that, which is amazing. And then, by the way, I mean, you got a picture of the outside, but look at the inside. God prepared this for us. Wow. I mean, it's just beautiful. Let's go ahead and flip through them, Ezra. This is where we're gonna be worshiping. By the way, it happened very fast in 2 Sundays from now. Not only does it have a great sanctuary for the adults, but God prepared a place for our kids too that's bigger than we could ever imagine. Look at the size of these rooms.
Wow.
Look at the size of these rooms where our kids are going to be at, worshiping God, hearing stories. They've even got a built-in stage for our kids as if it was meant to be. And on top of all of that, there's a great grass field and outside area where we're going to be having events, barbecues, outreaches, all those sorts of things right there by the lake. So, hey, when I said 5 minutes ago, God is good, now you know why I said it, right? Amen? So here's the details for you really quick. We're going to be there on the 23rd. That's 2 Sundays from now. Children's ministry is going to be there. Nursery is going to be there. Youth ministry is going to be there, okay? So we're moving there, but nothing is changing. Like, we are going to, when God says go, we're going, and we're going to continue on. We're going to be there. The first Sunday is the 23rd, and there is one other change that I need to let you know about. We're going to be starting service instead of 10:30, but starting on the 23rd, it will be every Sunday at 10 a.m., so 30 minutes early. So I heard a couple of applauses. That means much earlier. That's going to be 10 a.m. going forward. And so if you haven't figured it out yet, this is not by man, this is not by me, this is not by the elders. In fact, as much as I have a great respect for Steve, it's not even because of Steve, it's because of God. And what do? We play our part. And I just want you to know that the elders and the pastors of this church have walked faithfully into this, but we need you. That is the one thing, the one element that is missing, is you. And I've got numbers of what we need from you. You know, God has provided for us over this last year financially. And so if you were here when we moved to the rec center 5 years ago, I asked for money then. I don't have to do that now, which is amazing. But what I have to ask for is servants.
I need to ask for servants. And I need these servants to say today, not I'm going to think about it, not maybe next week. I need them today. This is what we need. God gave us so much space for children's ministry that we're going to be able to expand our children's ministry. But that means that in 2 weeks, I need 10 new volunteers. And I don't say that like in hopes. I say that like 10 people today before you walk out need to go to the Connection Center and sign up to volunteer in children's ministry. I need 10 for 2 weeks from now because we're expanding that ministry, not only because we have the space, but because we're expand the children's ministry is growing beyond belief. We've got 30 kids over there on an average Sunday right now, and so that's what I need. I need that. The other thing I need is we've got multiple entrances in this building. We need more greeters. That's an easy job. One Sunday a month, you show up and you smile. I need 8 more of those to sign up today. And we're going to need setup and tear down help. The good news is I only need 4 of those, but men in this room who can volunteer one Sunday a month, or even women, set up and tear down, moving signs, some simple things like that. I need 4 of those. And then the other thing I need is I need 4 new ushers. If you see the men walking around with walkie-talkies, they're keeping an eye on our children. They're keeping an eye on our youth ministry. They're keeping an eye on this. They're helping people get seated. We need 4 more of those. So I need 10 new volunteers in children's ministry. I need 8 new greeters. I need 4 new setup and tear down help, and I need 4 ushers. That's what I need from you. And I'm just asking, church, like, this is huge. People are going to come to the Lord because of what God is doing. And I'm just asking you all to play your part in that. So sign up for that on your way out today. I was going to ask Steve to say a couple of more things, but I think I'm just going to leave it there for now, and we'll tell you more later. I think the feeling and the spirit in the room right now is let's just glorify God. What do you guys say?
God is faithful, amen?
Amen.
God is good all the time. Stand up and sing of his goodness with him.
Thank you.
Promises morning when you walked in, you received a connection card. Please fill this out. It's the best way to stay connected to Woodlands. We have a lot going on, so if you'd like to be in the loop, please check the box that says text and email alerts. Here at Woodlands, we have a youth group, children's, and nursery ministry. If you're not sure what room your child belongs in, please go to the Connection Center and have those lovely ladies point you in the right direction. We want to thank everyone who gives faithfully through tithes and offerings. Woodlands is able to reach this community, serve this body, and make disciples because of everyday people like you and me who give faithfully. Offering is collected in the tall wooden box on the way out. Information and offering envelopes are on the ends of the aisles in those little carts. Also, you can now give online at woodlandscbc.org.
All right, y'all, there's this sneaky little verse in the Bible that says, to whom much is given, much is
required.
And so I'm asking a lot of you guys over these coming weeks and months, but I just got done asking for 26 people, new volunteers to volunteer for children's church, set up and tear down, ushering and all those things. But I have one more big ask for you. The one missing component we cannot miss is gratefulness and thankfulness for what this camp and ministry has done for us. This is Marco, and Marco's the head honcho around here. I know everybody thinks Steve is, but I've heard the opposite. Next Saturday from 9 to 3, Woodlands Church is partnering with also, what's the other organization?
Soldiers for Jesus.
Soldiers for Jesus. And we are going to be here supporting, helping, and working for this camp for a day. And I want you to know that I will be here at 9, and I'm staying till 3, right alongside anybody else that shows up. And if you can only be here 9 to noon, that's fine. If you can only be here from noon to 3, that's fine. You show up and you serve just as a sign of gratefulness to this camp. They're going to give us lunch in the middle of the day. But I just asked Marco to come up here and just share real quick about maybe the need and then what to expect. So go ahead, Marco.
Okay, I won't give you the long.
You won't give me the long, give me the short of it.
Steve Garcia, yeah, Steve Garcia minute. All right, Soldiers for Jesus, a motorcycle club. We are volunteering on Saturday to do some painting. We're going to be painting the Big Oak Cafe, and we're going to be doing some touch-up in here. While we were doing that, our numbers were not as high. So we said, hey, what about Woodlands Church? You know, let's give them the opportunity to serve as well. So we spoke with your elders, and they said, yeah, they were all in. They said, yes, we'll help. So I don't know the numbers yet, what we're going to do is we're going to be cleaning the exterior of this building. It's all the pine needles that you see, the tree limbs. We're going to be trimming some trees, and we have the Vermeer chipper over here, and she's hungry. She wants to make some wood chips. And so, and you don't need to bring anything. We'll have everything for you. We'll have rakes, glasses, masks, the whole thing. So you just got to bring yourself, and we'll set you up, and you can just, again, it is from 9 a.m. Then we'll be serving lunch at noon at 12, and then after that until about 3 o'clock. But it shouldn't take us that long to do this building.
Cool. Thanks, Marco. Appreciate it. And we appreciate what you guys have done for us. I will be here. I expect a good turnout of Woodlands people here serving this amazing ministry. Hey, so with that, now let's get into the Word this morning. What do you guys say? Get your Bibles out and open up to Luke chapter 1. Luke chapter 1, if you aren't in the habit of bringing your Bible to church, you are in the wrong habit. Bring your Bible to church on Sunday mornings. It's not important what I have to say or what any man or woman has to say. What's important is what God has to say. So make sure you have your Bible out and here on Sunday morning. If you ever forget your Bible or you need one, there's Bibles that are in the carts in the aisles. You're welcome to borrow one of ours. And you're even welcome to keep one of those if you need a Bible in hand. So Luke chapter 1, we have just begun a new journey here at Woodlands Church where we are going to be journeying through the New Testament, starting with Luke's gospel, chapter by chapter, book by book, verse by verse, and we have only just begun. And so if you weren't here last week, it doesn't matter, because we just started. And so just really quick, tiny bit of background as we move into the Word this morning. What is a gospel? A gospel is the story of Jesus' life. In the Bible, we have four of them, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. All the same story, written from different perspective. We're reading Luke. Luke was a doctor. Luke knew a bunch of the disciples, a bunch of the apostles. He was a part of the new church, but it's actually likely that Luke didn't even know Jesus personally, that everything he had here was researched and interviewed from people who had met Jesus. We started the story out last week at the beginning of chapter 1. We're going to finish chapter 1 today. And the story was particularly about two people by the name of Zechariah and Elizabeth. And Luke, like a great author, he doesn't just jump into the story of Jesus. He gives us a little bit of the prequel so that we understand the context and the story of what God has been orchestrating really over thousands of years through the Old Testament. We also learned about Mary, the mother of Jesus. And by the way, Zechariah and Elizabeth were the parents of John the Baptist. John the Baptist was the precursor to Jesus. He's the one that we're going to see in some coming chapters. He's going to prepare the way. He's going to be out in the wilderness preaching about the coming Messiah. And people are going to wander into the desert just to taste the goodness of God. That was John the Baptist's role. But if you remember the story from last week, it started in almost a bit of a humorous way, because Zechariah, he was a priest in the temple. He was a man of God, a man of faith. And an angel appears to him and says, "Hey, Zechariah, your wife, Elizabeth, who's been waiting for a child her whole life, is going to finally have a boy." An angel appeared and said this, to which Zechariah says, "Well, I'm old, and she's advanced in years, and the only way that I could really believe that is if you could just give me a sign," as if the angel wasn't enough. But Zechariah, as God often does, he gives us exactly what we ask for. Zechariah receives his sign, which is God causes his mouth, his tongue, to stop working until John the Baptist is born. The same very same angel comes to Mary and says, "Hey, Mary, big news. You are going to carry the Messiah, the Savior." To which she responds totally differently. She responds in faith. She says, "Lord, I don't know how this is going to happen, but," if you remember how we closed last week, she says, "but I am yours. You are mine. And whatever you say, Lord, whatever you say, may your will be done." Both of the mothers, Mary and Elizabeth, they both believed what the Bible said. They believed that God could do the impossible. They were both women of faith. They were both women who trusted in God, and they were women of submission, which is fascinating because Zechariah was the priest. Yet it was the women who stood up and said, these two mothers who stood up and said, "God, we believe. May the impossible come true." And so before we go any further, as God would line up this story for just a day like this, I think we do just need to stop for a moment and be reminded of the role that mothers play in our lives. For many of us, or probably most of us, it's our mothers who first planted the seeds of faith in our life. For many of us, before we could even believe in ourselves, who was it that believed in us? It wasn't good old dad. It was mom. Mom is always the one that's behind us, believing in us before we could ever believe in ourselves. It is mothers who send their child on the way that they're supposed to be. It's mothers who are in the home rearing their children and preparing them for their life, caring for them, doing the dirty work behind the scenes. Moms in this room, not only do we say Happy Mother's Day, but we say thank you. And what I want to do is I just want to have, if you're a mother, would you just stand up real quick so we can honor you? Mom, stand up. And don't sit down. Don't sit down just yet. I just want to say thank you for what you guys do for all of us, and I just want to pray a blessing over you guys. Father, we thank you for the mothers in this room. We thank you for the ones that are not. But Father, we thank you for the gift that mothers are to us. Father, we thank you for these women who have served us, who have served their children, who have served in this church, and who have given so selflessly to their children and to their families. Father, I pray you would bless each one of these women's lives, not just today, but Father, but forevermore, that you would take care of them and watch out for them, give them strength and health, and may their children be a grand blessing to them. We pray all together in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you, moms. You can have a seat. By the way, since I'm on stage, I get to say it. I've got the best. And not many people can say this. I even have the best mother-in-law. And my wife is the best mother of anybody's children. Wait, that didn't come out quite right. You guys get the picture. Let's jump into God's word. Verse 39. Luke 1, verse 39. We're going to read a nice big chunk here, 39 through 45. In those days, Mary arose and went with haste into the hill country to a town in Judah. And she entered the house of Zechariah and greeted Elizabeth. And when Elizabeth heard the greeting of Mary, the baby leapt in her womb. And Elizabeth was filled with the Holy Spirit. And she exclaimed with a loud cry, "Blessed are you among women, and blessed is the fruit of your womb. And why is this granted to me that the mother of my Lord should come to me? For behold, when the sound of your greeting came to my ear, the baby in my womb leaped for joy. And blessed is she who believes that there would be a fulfillment of what was spoken to her from the Lord." So we're jumping back into this story. Both Zechariah and Elizabeth, they receive from the angel that they're going to birth a son, John the Baptist. Mary receives the same word that she's going to be the mother of the Savior, of the Messiah. But what Luke doesn't catch or capture or write in this section of Scripture is the difficulty that this was going to be. We miss that in these verses. Like, for Mary to be engaged and then to turn up pregnant, well, not only was that a social issue, but back in the day, back in ancient times, she could be kicked out of her town. She could be shunned by her family, or even worse, she could even be stoned. Her life could be taken. So, like, we celebrate the birth of Jesus on Christmas like we should, but maybe not realizing what it was that Mary was called to do. Mary was called to do something greatly difficult, something very hard, something that would bring her much trial and tribulation. And so what does she do? She runs off in haste, the Bible says. She runs off to this other town, to this other place, and she runs off to her cousin's house, Elizabeth and Zechariah. And she goes there and spends time with them, both to protect herself, to protect her baby. And the truth of the matter is, though Mary for herself, she has a great explanation. This is the Savior of the world. I swear. Like, she has a great explanation. Like, that's probably, she does. But it's probably not going to fly in her hometown with her friends and her family. And so she wanders off, she runs off to stay with these people. But what I want you to see here is not just this running and hiding. I want you to see what she runs to. She runs to not just family, but she runs to relationship. I beat this drum all the time, but I beat it only because it's in Scripture. I beat the drum of relationship because it's in Scripture. You see, relationship has power. And when Mary's life was in danger, her livelihood was in danger, what does she do? She runs to a safe place of relationship with someone that she can trust. When she's faced with the most difficult of circumstances, what does she do? She runs to someone who shares her beliefs, who shares her faith, who shares her trust in God, and there she feels safe. Notice how Elizabeth receives her. Elizabeth receives her in joy. She's elated. The Bible says she was filled with the Holy Spirit and just filled with this joy. There for several months, Mary finds support. She finds care. She finds understanding. She finds shelter. She finds provision. All during a time that actually could have been completely disastrous. You see, that's the power of the Christian relationship. And if I could just take it a step further, that is the power of the church. You see, sometimes those words, they don't carry the meaning they should. We think of churches coming together at 10:30 to worship God and to sing, and though that is a part of church, church is so much more. Church is having people like Mary and Elizabeth in your life that you can run to in a moment of tragedy or in a moment of joy, to a moment of pain and a moment of suffering, and say, I need you. And what is the church supposed to do? Your closest friends that are in your small group, in your Bible study, like, they embrace you. They give you a safe place. They embrace you with joy. They support you, and they understand. Like, understand in this that God could have done 101 things. God could have done 101 different things. Yet what does he do? The story he writes is of life-changing and life-saving relationship. God could have done any sort of miracle to provide for Mary. He could have done any sort of miracle to make sure that she and the baby were safe. But what does he give her? He gives her the church. He gives a relationship and friendship that's both life-giving and life-saving. And again, I don't think these 7 or 8 verses even capture the beauty and the value of the relationship that's going on here. Can you imagine both of these two women both being given the gift of child miraculously by God? Can you imagine the bond that formed with them together over several months? The deep relationship, the sharing, the caring, the understanding, this deep bond that would have formed. You see, people would have been scoffing at Elizabeth being past the age of childbearing. They would have scoffed at Mary saying, this is from God, I swear. But these two together, they knew, they understood, they supported. That's the beauty of the relationship that we should have inside of the church. It's one another. You see that all throughout Scripture, in the New Testament and the Old, that there's always, with God's people, this coming together because we are far stronger together than we can ever be alone. You see, this time could have been tragic for Mary. It could have been disastrous. But instead, she gets to live with Zechariah and Elizabeth in joy, in peace, in understanding. And so what flows out of Mary's heart? Worship flows out of Mary's heart. Look at verse 46. We're going to read this song. As she's received into Zechariah and Elizabeth's house, and she's so filled and moved with joy, care, relationship, and acceptance, worship literally flows out of her heart. This is Mary's song. My soul magnifies the Lord, and my spirit rejoices in God my Savior, for he has looked on the humble estate of his servant. For behold, from now on, all generations will call me blessed. For he who is mighty has done great things for me, and holy is his name. And his mercy is for those who fear him from generation to generation. He has shown strength with his arm. He has scattered the proud in their thoughts of their hearts. He has brought down the mighty from their thrones and exalted those humble estates. He has filled the hungry with good things, and the rich he has sent away empty. He has helped his servant Israel in remembrance of his mercy, as he spoke to our fathers, to Abraham, and to his offspring forever. And Mary remained with her about 3 months and then returned home. This passage, though none of the lyrics line up directly, this passage and what's happening with Mary so much reminds me of a song that we often sing here, the song called Graves to Gardens. One of the songs and one of the lines that we always sing so loudly is, the God of the mountains is the God of the valley. And again, though we rejoice and celebrate Mary, man, this is what Mary is facing. On one hand, she is on fire for the Lord. Worship is coming out of her heart and through her mouth. And she is just saying, God is so good because he's watched out for me, taken care of me, and protected me, and allowed me to be the mother of the Messiah. While at the same time, there's this feeling of valley. I don't know what's coming next. I don't know what my family is going to think. I don't know about Joseph. I don't know how the town is going to receive me again. But yet, what does she do? Whether she's on the mountain or she's in the valley, she turns her heart to one place, to her God. What an amazing example of a godly woman. And again, I just have to tell you, I didn't plan that this would be today's passage. It just happened to be today's passage. But yet, what do we see? We see God giving us a word of what it looks like to be a godly woman and a godly mother. Well, what is Mary? Why is Mary exemplify a godly woman and mother? Well, first and foremost, her life is just all about worship. Talked about this in the past. Yes, worship is singing and praising, but worship is also the lifestyle you choose. And what has Mary done? She's given up everything for what God says. Mary is also a woman of God's word. You want to be a godly woman? You want to be a godly mother? Be a woman of God's word. This flows out of Mary's heart and her mind for memory. Do you know what most of this is? This is quotation from the Old Testament. Mary knew the scripture. She knew the word. Want to be a godly woman and live a life of worship. Be a woman of the word. What else is Mary? Mary is selfless. She looks the angel in the eye and says, "This plan of God sounds frightening. And I'm not sure what's going to come," but she says, "Not my will, God, but yours." Godly woman, a godly mother is selfless. What else does Mary do? Whether she's on the mountain or she's in the valley, she chooses joy. What's coming out of her heart is the joy of the Lord. And then finally, we see that Mary is humble. That's in four or five of these verses here. Humble, humble, humility, humility. And what is that? We use that word humility, we use that word humble. What does it mean? It means making much of Jesus and making much of others and not making much of ourselves. And that's the truth of Mary's life. Mary says, "As you choose, God, I will do." She becomes the mother of the Savior. When Jesus comes on the scene, not a lot happens with Mary in the rest of the gospel, but that's because she cared not about herself or her status. She cared not about what God was going to give to her or do for her. She cared about doing exactly what God wanted, which was making much of Jesus and making much of others. Let's move on to the story, verses 57 through 66. 57 through 66. "Now the time came for Elizabeth to give birth." Remember, she's the mother of John the Baptist, which we'll read about more later. "Now the time came for Elizabeth to give birth, and she bore a son. And her neighbors and relatives heard that the Lord had shown her great mercy, and they rejoiced with her. And on the eighth day, they came to circumcise the child, and they would have called him Zechariah after his father. But his mother answered, 'No, he shall be called John.' And they said to her, 'None of your relatives is called by this name.' And they made signs to his father, inquiring what he wanted him to be called. And he asked for a writing tablet and wrote, 'His name is John.'" By the way, culturally, you would name your child after yourself or somebody in your family. And so when they want to name him, when Elizabeth and Zechariah want to name him John, everybody's confused, like, well, so who's the father? That's what's going on here. So they're all wondering what in the world is happening. Verse 64, "And immediately his mouth was open and his tongue loosed, and he spoke blessing God. And fear came on all their neighbors, and all these things were talked about through all the hill country in Judea. And all who heard them laid them up in their hearts, saying, 'What then will this child be? For the hand of the Lord is with him.'" This is like one of the sneaky best parts of Luke chapter 1. Like, it's one of the best parts of the story, because if you remember what I've told you about Zechariah, Zechariah was a priest of the temple who, when his wife Elizabeth and Mary said, "God, we believe," he said, "I don't really believe." He says, "Prove it. I want a sign. Even if an angel is standing in front of me." He doubted, but did you see what happens in this passage? He watched what happened with Mary, and then he watched what happened with his wife Elizabeth. Now he sees the son, whose name is to be John, and in the instant in which he obeys God, his mouth is opened. The instant that he obeys the word of God, his mouth is opened. Zechariah, after seeing, his conviction is renewed. And he's convicted so much that he says, "No, this kid's name is not named after me. His name is John." Got a couple of things I want to tell you about this passage. First and foremost, God is the God of second chances. God is the God of second chances. Zechariah, the priest, who went into the temple to make incense and worship and pray for all of Israel, who doubted and had faith, what does God give this man? The man that was supposed to be the example, who was supposed to be the holiest, who was supposed to be the leader of all of these people. What did he give? What did God even give this man? A second chance. Yes. Yes. God will give you a second chance, even when you doubt. Yes, God will give you a second chance, even when you question. Yes, God will give you a second chance even when you fail and when you stumble. And yes, God will give you a second chance even when you fill in the blank. That is the God of grace. The God of grace says, here's your second chance, even when. Sometimes we get a bit confused by God's timing. For Zechariah, it was at least 9 months. It could have been longer, in which he lost his voice. God took it away. But you have to understand something about God's timing. Sometimes we wait around and say, God, when is my chance coming? When are you going to give me an opportunity to be reconciled with this person? When are you going to give me an opportunity to ask forgiveness for this thing? When are you going to give me the opportunity? When is my second chance? And here's what we have to understand about God. We see the count, the minutes and the seconds and the hours and the months and the years counting down. But God doesn't. God lives outside of this thing that we call time. And I promise you, by God's word, that you will get your second chance. It might be in 9 minutes from now. It might be in 9 hours from now. It might be in 9 weeks from now. It might be in 9 decades from now. But if you walk the walk of obedience, he will bring deliverance. Which is the second thing I want to say about this passage. Obedience brings deliverance. You need a breath of hope this morning? This is all you need. How do I get the miracle that I need? How do I find the deliverance that I've been begging for? Man, it's right here in the Word. You don't need some guy like me to tell you. You walk the journey of faithful obedience, and God will deliver. Amen. Zechariah walked a difficult path for 9 months, but the moment he put his foot down and said, his name is John, there was deliverance. In that instant, God delivered. So I just say, if you're here waiting for your second chance, or you're waiting for your miracle, or you're waiting for your deliverance, it's coming. That second chance, by the way, we just say second chance is a number. Your third chance, your fourth chance, your fifth chance, your sixth chance, your seventh chance, your eighth chance, your ninth chance, your tenth chance. We want to get going to lunch, I understand. But you guys get what I'm getting at here? Like, God is the God that will always give you that second chance. He will always prove himself faithful. He will always deliver you. What is your job? Your job is to do what Zechariah learned the hard way, to walk obediently in faith. For time this morning, I'm not going to read verses 69 to 79. What happens in this passage, I encourage you to go back and read it for yourself. What happens in this passage is so similar to what happens with Mary. Zechariah sees that his son John had been born. His mouth is open, and so where does his heart turn? The very same place. God, you are so good. Blessed be your name. You have brought us salvation. You have rescued us. On and on and on. And verse by verse by verse, Zechariah turns to worship and prophecy. So similar to what we saw with Mary. And what is the heart of the story? What is kind of the bottom line of this story? What can we take away from Elizabeth and Mary and Zechariah? Well, I think it's pretty simple. Particularly when you think of the end of the story here with Zechariah. Zechariah had a choice. You know what he chose? It's not going to sound too profound. Zechariah chose faith. He just chose it. He chose faith over doubt. He chose faith over question. He chose faith over logic. He chose faith over what was easy. He chose faith, this may be the most important part for us. He chose faith over feelings. Don't let your feelings win the battle today. Amen. Let your faith win the battle today. Zechariah also chose faith over fear. Don't let fear dictate who you are or where you're going to go or what you're going to do. Don't let fear dictate how you're going to worship God or how you're not. And walk in faith. Faith is a decision. Faith is not a feeling. We get so caught up with feelings in this world. I feel this. I think this. No. No. Believers, the church, Christians, they do not live by feeling. They live by faith. And all you have to do is look at this story. What did Mary choose to do? She said, God, I'm going to live by faith. What did Elizabeth choose to do? She said, God, I'm too old for this, but I'm going to live by faith. And then Zechariah, at the end of the story, he says, you know what? I'm done with this doubting. I am going to live by faith. And the lesson is the same for us. Believers do not live by feeling. We do not live by fear. We do not live by the word of man. We do not live by the word of the world. We live only by the word of God and by faith. Leave feeling aside. Leave man's word aside. Follow God at his word. And when we find that faith, and when Mary found that faith, and when Elizabeth found it, and finally when Zechariah found it, notice what they do. Their hearts are turned not to themselves, not to their story, not to what's next. All of their hearts are turned to worshiping the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. So that's what we're going to do right now. We're going to sing a song called Give Me Faith. Because we aren't going to be a church that lives by thought or by feeling. We're going to be a people who live by faith. So you guys stand and sing now with us.
every week here at Woodlands, as most of you probably know, we do communion in remembrance of Jesus and all that he did for us. I'm going to repeat just a short bit here out of Mary's song. It says that Mary said, "My soul glorifies the Lord. My spirit rejoices in God my Savior, for he has been mindful of the humble state of his servant. From now on, all generations will call me blessed, for the Mighty One has done great things for me. Holy is his name. His mercy extends to those who fear him from generation to generation. He has performed mighty deeds with his arm. He has scattered those who are proud in their inmost thoughts. He has brought down rulers from their thrones, but he has lifted up the humble." As we take communion today, let's pray that we're all able to humble ourselves before the Lord, lay aside all of our pride, and just let the Spirit blow in us and identify all of the sins that we may be struggling with, or any of the pride that we're having trouble laying aside. And then after that, just rise up in his mercy, because a lot of times, you know, we can look at communion as a somber time or as a celebratory time, but most of the time I think that it should be both. So we'll take communion individually. I think if anybody needs it, they're there to pass them around. And I'll just say a quick prayer, and we will we'll get to it. Lord, I thank you for all that you do in our lives, Lord. And I thank you for your grace, for the second chances that you offer all of us, Lord. And God, I just pray that let the Spirit fill us all today in this church, Lord. Let us all confess to you all of the areas that we struggle, Lord. And then let us all walk forward in your grace, in your mercy, Lord. Accept the forgiveness that Jesus Christ bought for us on the cross, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen.
Take the example of Mary this morning. Let's stand and just worship God for his greatness towards us. Let's express him our gratitude. Song must end.
get shy on me, lift up your song. Cause you got a lion inside those lungs. Get up and praise the Lord. Come on, my soul, don't you get shy on me, lift up your song. Cause you got a lion inside.
Promises are always true. Have another day.